understand what the Pythagorean theorem is and how it applies to right triangles. So still playing with triangles, but now we're going to be working with side lengths rather than angles. You will use the Pythagorean theorem to find the missing measures of right triangles, and you will understand how to identify the missing measures of diagonals in the real world. This lesson goes along with you having a calculator. You're really going to need one to keep up with us, so hopefully you have one. Okay. Can you do it without a calculator? Yeah, this might take you a little bit longer. All right, so this is the introduction to the Pythagorean theorem. Lots of stuff you gotta learn before we can even introduce you to the theorem. Down there. So, the Pythagorean theorem, invented by an old man long, long time ago. His name was Pythagoras. He was eventually killed. They killed him while he was doing a mathematical equation. True story. He was so busy, wrapped up in his math, when the Romans came and sacked his... By the way, this history lesson may or may not be true. Part of it's true, part of it I might be making up. Anyway, so, story goes, he was so involved in his mathematical computations, Pythagoras invented a lot of stuff that you see in here. So he was a torturer of children, obviously, because he created a lot of math stuff for you guys to do. He was so involved in his equations that he didn't notice when he was being killed by the Romans. So the story goes, once again, I'm not a history teacher. I did not pretend to be. I teach math. If the history lesson's wrong, Okay, so the Pythagorean theorem is a useful tool when trying to find the missing side lengths of a right triangle. We can only use the Pythagorean theorem when we're talking about right triangles. No other types of triangles, just right ones. Well, it seems like it's not that useful if you want to use right triangles. But there's a lot of uses, as you'll see later on. So right triangles. How do we know if it's a right triangle? We look at the triangle. Two of the sides should form, what's this little sign right here?
A right angle.
Now, you might not always have this little symbol here, so you're looking for basically two lines that meet at a perpendicular angle. Perpendicular meaning 90 degrees, aka right angle. Okay, so the two smaller sides of the right triangle, the two smallest sides of the triangle will always form a right angle. So you're gonna have three sides, because it's a triangle. Two small sides form a right angle. Then you have this longer side right here. I'll tell you what the name of that is in a second. So the sides of the right triangle, when we're talking about the Pythagorean theorem, are gonna have very unique names when we're using the Pythagorean theorem. The two smaller sides that form a right angle are known as the legs. So our triangle has two legs, and our legs will meet at a right angle. That is very important to remember. The legs always form the right angle. It's very important to remember when we're solving. Sometimes we'll be finding a missing leg, sometimes I'm missing this thing right here, which is known as the hypotenuse. Hypotenuse. The hypotenuse is always the longest side of the triangle. Always the longest side. That is very important as well. If I were to give you three side lengths of a right triangle, let's say they were 4, 5, and 3. I'm gonna repeat this just to make sure I have all your attentions. The hypotenuse has to be the longest side. So if I said a triangle had three sides and the sides measured 4, 5, and 3, which one does the hypotenuse have to be?
Five.
It has to be 5, it's always the longest side. Keep that in mind for the end of the lesson. Okay, so that's my hypotenuse. And then when we use a theorem, we're going to label the sides a certain way as well. The two legs are interchangeably labeled A and B. Doesn't matter which one you label A, doesn't matter which one you label B. Either of the legs can be A, either of them can be B. But one must be A, one must be B. The hypotenuse will always be labeled C, always. Hypotenuse is the side that does not form part of the right angle. Do you see a right angle up here?
No.
Do you see one down here?
No.
No. That's your hypotenuse. The two sides that form the right angle are your legs. You have got to get that to stick in your head. If you don't, you're going to get a lot of these wrong because of simple mistakes. Yes?
About like that rectangle, wouldn't they all be legs?
No.
Because they all form a right angle?
They don't form a right angle, sir.
Yes,
we're looking here. Actually, let's look closer. This side right here and this side. This vertex is a right angle. We agree. This side and this side right here, we're looking at C. Together, they do not form a right angle.
I was talking about the rectangle.
I'm not talking about the rectangle. We're talking just about the triangles. We're talking just about this right triangle because at the very beginning of the lesson, we talked about the Pythagorean theorem is a useful tool for trying to find the missing side length of a what? Just a right triangle. Only use it, a right triangle. Rectangle has nothing to do with this because there's actually something in the rectangle that's going to appear. Watch, there's going to be something in there in a second. But I didn't show it to you. You must wait for me to reveal what to you. It's coming shortly. I will show you what it is. Okay, so now that we know Pythagorean theorem only be used with right triangles, not valid in all 50 states, some offers do not apply. It has special names. The two sides that form the right angle are known as the legs. You have one, two legs, so does a triangle. Two legs, they form a right angle. The other side, the diagonal side, depending on which way its orientation is, just notice that this long side here does not form a right angle here. Oh yeah, that is known as your hypotenuse. Got it? Yes, good, okay. Now, very last thing, the legs are gonna be labeled A or B. That's interchangeable. Doesn't matter which leg is labeled A, which one is labeled B. What really matters is you understand the hypotenuse is gonna be what? C. And then we can introduce the theorem. It says this. If you take the legs of a right triangle, A and B, and you square them and add them together, they will equal the length of the hypotenuse, which is C squared. Here we have an example of what we can use the Pythagorean theorem for. For this example here, we're being asked to find the length of the diagonal side. This, if you notice, does not form a right angle. This is the what? A leg or the hypotenuse? The hypotenuse. Remember, hypotenuse is C. Hypotenuse is always on the right side of the equation all by itself. And we look at what we do know. We know that this leg measures 5 units. We don't know what it is, inches or centimeters, so we say units. This leg measures 12 units. So what we do is we take what we know, A and B, these are legs, doesn't really matter which way you order them, and we substitute them into the theorem. So 5 goes in for A, 12 goes in for B. Notice, it doesn't matter which way you do this. It doesn't matter if you do 12 and 5, 5 and 12, as long as the legs are on the left side, hypotenuse is on the right side. We know what the legs are, we're trying to solve for the hypotenuse, so we substitute all of these values into the theorem. 5 squared plus 12 squared equals C squared. Always ask yourself when you're solving these problems, before you start solving them, ask yourself a question. Am I solving for a missing leg or a missing hypotenuse? What are you solving for?
Missing
hypotenuse. That way you know you'll always be solving for C, for hypotenuse. For a leg, you'll always be solving for A or B. It's very important the way you set them up, as you'll see later on. So, 5 squared plus 12 squared equals C squared. We're trying to solve for C. Am I trying to solve for C squared?
No,
I'm trying to solve for just C, which means that at some point, I'm gonna have to get rid of this exponent. We'll see who remembers how to do that. So, 5 squared is what?
25.
Plus 12 squared.
144.
So we get 25 plus 144 is equal to C squared. So we square both the values. Squaring means 5 times 5, 12 times 12. In your calculator, you can hit 5, and then there should be a little X2 button. It's right here on your calculator. That's to square. So, once you square them, that's an addition sign. It's telling you to do what? Makes sense. So you get 169 is equal to C squared. If you leave it like that, it is wrong. Because you're trying to find, not C squared, you're trying to find C. So, we have to get rid of the exponent. Let's see if you remember the answer to this question. The opposite of squaring something is taking the square
root.
So we have to take the square root of this. But remember, what you do on one side, you must do on the other side. So over here, if we take the square root of C squared, we end up with just C. The exponent is gone. But if we do it on the right side, we must do it on the left side. So in your calculator now, you're going to take the square root of 169. What is it? It's a perfect square. What'd you get?
13.
Square root button. Hold on, sorry. Square root button is right next to the square button. Square root. Okay? Yes.
So isn't it just basically like a new way to solve the equation?
I mean, it's not a new way to solve an equation. It's just a different type of equation. I mean, it's a theorem and we're solving equations. So if you already know how to solve an equation with an exponent, which you do, really all this becomes is substitution. You're substituting in. The only true way you can mess this up is by substituting these values into the wrong place. Like if I were to put 12 in for C, is that correct?
No.
These are the legs, they go on the left, hypotenuse goes on the right. Yes.
Would it be the same thing if you use C equals 5 plus 12? Would it be the same thing?
No, it wouldn't, because that gives you 17. Take the root of 17. Well, what's 5 plus 12? 17, right?
Yeah.
C does not equal 17. C equals 13. That's why you have to square, and then add it together, then take the root. It changes things. It does. Because if you were just to do 5 and 12, that would say C equals 17. C does not equal 17. The theorem specifically says you must square A, square B. If you add them together, that's going to be equal to C squared. That little square changes things. It makes it extraordinary. And you know what the difference is between ordinary and extraordinary? Just that little extra. All
right.
Oh, look, more cheesy stuff. We're melting. Yay! All right, so here, I've taken this triangle and I spun it around, and it stopped here. Make sure you identify where the right angle is and where the hypotenuse is. Looking here, what am I trying to solve for? Always ask yourself that.
Hypotenuse.
The hypotenuse. I hope everybody sees that. What am I trying to solve for? The hypotenuse. How do you know?
Because
this long side here does not form part of the right angle. Leg, hypotenuse. So we take these values and I substitute them into the theorem. 6 squared plus 9 squared, they're both legs, is equal to x squared. And the reason I put x instead of c is because they labeled it as x. We know it's c. We know it's the hypotenuse. They're using a variable instead. That's totally fine. I'm showing you all the different looks you can get here. Still the same thing. We're going to square them. What's 6 squared?
36.
What's 8 squared?
81.
That's going to give you 36 plus 81 equals x squared. You add them together, you will get 117 equals x squared. If you remember your perfect square, is 117 a perfect square?
No,
it's not. So make sure you pay careful attention to what we do here. We are going to take the root of both sides. However, I want you to do this. Put 117 into your calculator and take the root. What do you get?
10.81655.
You get an irrational number. Because technically, although it ends in your calculator, that number goes on and on without terminating or repeating. So you have to kind of look at the problem. Most of them will just have you round it to a certain digit. For me, I'm going to have you round it to the nearest thousand, which would be 817. And then remember these little things? What does that mean, those three dots? It doesn't terminate. It goes on and on with no specific pattern. It's an irrational number. It's a non-terminating, non-repeating decimal. You have to include the dots. That's one way to answer it. The other way to answer it is to do this. You just eliminate the square and you keep the radical sign, which is what that's called. X is equal to the root of 117. Either one. It depends on how they want you to answer it. Either one of them is technically correct. That's why you have to read the question. If it says, find the length of the hypotenuse round to the nearest tenth, hundred, thousand, whatever, you would round accordingly. If it says, just find the length of the hypotenuse, probably leave that as a good answer. If it says, leave it in radical form, that works. Because that's called the radical sign. It's radical, bro. Yeah, dude.
Yeah, bro.
Nice
calculator, bro.
You guys are so wise.
Anyway, hypotenuse. Questions on this? Questions on this? Okay.
Just one better, hello? Figure it out. How hard can you do this?
Okay. So I want you to look at something carefully here. Notice that we are given how many right triangles?
Three.
One, two, three. Right triangles. We're being asked to find the length of X. Is that possible?
Yes.
Is it possible without solving some other things first?
No,
it's not. Here's what you're going to need to do to solve this problem. If you look at the bottom here, I know the legs, right? And if I know these two legs, I can probably figure out what the length of, we'll just call it C. I can figure out what that is, right? Now, I want you to look very carefully. In this triangle, this hypotenuse is also the same as this triangle's what, leg or hypotenuse?
Hypotenuse.
No. Here's the hypotenuse, for the next one, it's the leg. So by solving for this hypotenuse, we're actually finding this triangle's leg. Then you repeat the process, leg, leg, and you would solve for the hypotenuse again. And finally, you'd know the leg and the leg and be able to solve for that hypotenuse. Watch how we do this. And the reason I'm showing you this, this is the Pythagorean theorem applied. This would be easy. You have to know how to apply it to a greater, higher order problem. So we start at the bottom. We know that if we can find this side right here, that allows us to find this side, finally that side. So we substitute into our theorem. We're going to have 3 squared plus 4 squared. We're at the bottom. That gives me 9 plus 16 is equal to c squared, which means 25 is equal to c squared. At this point, what do we have to do to get c alone? Take the square root of both sides, and we find out that c is equal to 5. So if we know that c equals 5, we now know the length of this hypotenuse, which is also the other triangle's length. So this whole thing right here is 5. So looking at the next triangle, do we know the lengths of both the legs now? Yes or no? Yes, we do. Bottom is 5, this is 12. So 12 squared plus 5 squared equals c squared. And you repeat the process. 144 plus 25 is equal to c squared. You add those together, this number looks familiar. 169 equals c squared. We did this already. We take the root of both of them. C equals what? 13. Because we already did that one. So now we know the length of that triangle's hypotenuse, which is also the last triangle's bottom leg. I'll wait for you guys to catch up your writing. You see what we're doing here? By finding this hypotenuse, we're also technically finding the middle triangle's leg. By finding the middle triangle's hypotenuse, we're finding the top triangle's bottom leg. Once we know this leg and this leg, we can find that hypotenuse. So, 84 squared plus 13 squared is equal to x squared. Can somebody do 84 times 84 for me? Tell me what you get.
7,056.
Plus 13 squared, which is 169, equals x squared. If you add those together, you should get 7,225. Yes? Yes. 7,225 is equal to x squared. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that this is a perfect square, because I know them all up to 100. So if you take the square root of that,
85.
I was going to do it. But well, yeah, it's 85. All right. Yeah, so x equals 85. Great job.
Team.
X is equal to 85. Good job, team! Oh,
let's go!
Let's go,
thanks.
Just one. Questions on how we did this? Okay. Then, so far, we've been trying to find the length of the hypotenuse. Obviously, that's not always going to be the case. If we look at this triangle here, we always ask ourselves this question first. In this problem, what am I trying to find? The length of a leg or the length of the hypotenuse?
Leg.
A leg. And this is where you have to be careful. Just about everybody can find the hypotenuse. A lot of people run into problems when we start trying to find the length of a leg. Not because it's hard, but because they set it up wrong. When we're trying to find the length of a leg, realize that we know the hypotenuse. So on the right side, it's not going to be the letter C anymore. It's going to be 37, the hypotenuse, squared. How do I know we're trying to find the length of a leg? Because this side forms part of the
right angle,
and it's one of the shorter sides. It doesn't really matter if you make this A or B. I made it A. Just know that this is going to be on the left side. So on the left side, if you notice, we have A squared plus 12 squared, the other leg, equals the hypotenuse 37 squared. You have to be careful when you're setting this up. When you're trying to find the leg, the variable will be on the left side, along with the length of the other leg. And then you solve it like you would solve any other equation. A squared stays the same, plus what is 12 squared? 144 equals what is 37 squared. Make sure you guys are doing this in your calculators so you can practice on this. 1369. And I want everyone to make sure that they're putting these in their calculator. This will remove simple errors when you're doing this on your own. such as multiplying the number by 2 or not squaring it correctly. Put this in your calculator, this is what you should get. 12 squared is 144, 37 squared is 169. Now realize that we have to get a square alone. So, Julio, what do I do? I need to get this alone, so I have to get rid of this. What's the opposite of a positive 144? No, what's the opposite of positive 144? We're solving a two-step equation here. You need to get this term, the a squared, alone. So you have to get rid of this constant. How do I get rid of this?
Negative.
Yeah, subtract 144 from both sides. My writing's a little crooked, whatever. And you get a squared is equal to 1225. Now that I have this alone, I need to get rid of the exponent. So what do I have to do? I take the square root of both sides, and that's going to give me a is equal to 34?
35.
35. A is equal to 35, which means the length of this leg is 35. You can also check your work here. Keep in mind that this hypotenuse must always be the largest side. Is it the largest side?
Yeah.
Yes. 12 is smaller than 37, 35 is smaller than 37, so our answer makes reasonable sense. If you got an answer like, I don't know, 85, does that make reasonable sense?
No, of course
not. No, because now you're telling me that this leg is the largest side. That is a lie. So, the leg here is equal to 35. Any questions on how we got that? Yes or no? What's up?
How did you find A? Like the last step? What was the last step?
I took the square root of both sides. Same thing like we did when we were finding the hypotenuse. Once you get the A squared or whatever term alone, if it's squared, it's gonna be alone on one side. Something like this. You end up with something like A squared equals 49. Once you get to this point, remember we're not solving for A squared, we're solving for A. So to get rid of the exponent, we take the square root. Squared, square root. If it was cubed, we take the cubic root. But this is the Pythagorean theorem. We never have to worry about cubes here. Square root, this becomes A equals what?
Seven.
Square root of 49 is 7, because 7 times 7 equals 49. Okay.
So what are the square root of C is?
It's not C, man. We could be solving for A, B, or C. It's whatever the square root, whatever number's left on one side of the equation. If you have just this type of variable term with an exponent of 2 on the other side of the equation, then take the root of both sides. Whatever that root is, that's your answer. Okay? All right. But don't say A, B, or C because you could be solving for different things. All right? Okay. So, we have this. Boom! TV. Now, JP has a 73-inch beautiful flat screen here that has a length of 55 inches. What is the height of the TV? If you remember from the video, Manuel, when we talk about a 73-inch flat screen, that's 73 inches, what are we talking about? The height, the length? We're talking about the diagonal. So that means that they're giving us, actually let me do this in red so it stands out more. They're giving us the length of the diagonal. They're saying that this is 73 inches. We also know the length. And we're being told that this is 55 inches. What don't we know?
The height.
So you have to ask yourself this question. Am I solving for the length of a leg or the length of the hypotenuse?
Length of a leg.
The length of a leg. So be very careful when you set this up. Let me ask you guys a question. What side is the variable going to be on, the left or the right?
The left.
We're solving for a leg. It's going to be x squared. The legs are on the left. Hypotenuse is on the right. You with me?
Yeah.
X squared plus 55 squared is equal to 73 squared. I already know the hypotenuse. The hypotenuse is all alone by itself on the right side of the equation. The legs are on the left side. Okay, so now that we've set this up, we're solving for a leg, so my variable goes on the left. Remember, the legs are on the left, hypotenuse is on the right. So we'll square. 55 squared is 3,025. Equals 73 squared is going to be, hold on, I got this. No, somebody else had it. Somebody else want to get this one?
53.29.
Okay, so once we do this, keep in mind what you're doing. You need to get this term alone before you take the root. So to do that, get rid of the 3,025. How do I do that?
I subtract
it from both sides of the equation. This is not really new when you get to this part. We've done this. This is solving equations. We did this in Module 7. X squared is equal to 2304?
Yes.
2304. Then you have to go in and you have to take the root of both sides. When you take the root of both sides, what are you gonna get?
48.
So x equals 48, which means the height of this TV is 48 inches. Always keep in mind when you're doing this, there's a reason I'm saying this over and over and over. Having taught this as long as I do, the most common area for mistakes is when people set up the equation. They put the variable in the wrong spot. You're solving for leg, variable's on the
left.
You're solving for the hypotenuse, the variable goes on the
right.
And then just solve it out. Make sure you take the root at the end. Questions? Questions?
No.
Okay, so the converse. When I say converse, I don't mean the shoes. We're talking about the converse of the Pythagorean theorem. So we know Pythagorean theorem. A squared plus B squared must equal what?
C squared.
And we know that we only use the Pythagorean theorem for what type of triangles?
Right triangles.
Right triangles. Only for right triangles. So the converse states that if A squared plus B squared equals C squared, then if it's a true statement, we're talking about a right triangle. So we can use the converse to prove that three measures of a triangle, in fact, form a right triangle. For example, supplemental. If we have 3 squared plus 4 squared, and this is a right triangle, this has to be 5 squared, because we need a true statement. True statement, remember, right? Same thing on both sides. So let's see. 9 plus 16 equals 25. What's 9 plus 16?
25.
So if you solve this for three measures and you get a true statement, that means we're talking about a right triangle. However, if we did this, 3 squared plus 4 squared equals 10 squared, are we talking about a right triangle now?
No, we're not,
and here's why. This becomes 9 plus 16 equals 100. Does 25 equal 100?
No,
it's false, so this would not be a right triangle. Still a triangle, but if these were the side lengths, this would not be a right triangle, okay? So that's what we're doing here. Now, the way you have to set this up is you first have to remember that the hypotenuse is always the
longest
or largest side. So if I gave you three measures, 8, 17, and 15, which one of those has to be the hypotenuse?
17.
And then you set up your equation like this to test and see if it's true. It would become 8 squared plus 15 squared. These are my legs. Because they are the smaller measures, hypotenuse is always the largest one. So I do 8 squared plus 15 squared equals 17 squared. If I get a true statement here, that means that this is, in fact, a what? A right triangle. If I get a false statement, it is not a right triangle. Question?
Why is the hypotenuse in the middle now?
Hypotenuse wasn't in the middle. I just rearranged the numbers. The hypotenuse, when you set up the equation, where's the hypotenuse? I was just giving you three different measures. If I put them in order, it's too easy to see. But if I give you three numbers, such as, let's just do this. Let's do 17, 6, and 15. Which one of these has to be the hypotenuse?
17.
So the reason I rearrange them is so it wasn't just given to you in order. You have to know that whatever the larger value is, that's going to take on the role of the hypotenuse in your equation. So what if I gave you 100, 99, and 101? Which one is the hypotenuse? 101. The other two would be the?
Legs.
Okay, you get where we're going?
Legs.
And we're checking to see if we get a true statement. So here, somebody had a question?
What if they're the same number?
They can't be the same number because it has to be the largest side. So if you had something like this, here's how you can test it. This wouldn't be true. 15, 15, and 50. Here's why it wouldn't be true. 225, right? 15 squared plus 15 squared equals 15 squared plus 225. Is that going to equal 225?
No.
There's no way they can all be the same size. That's not a right triangle. And it would actually, think about it. Would that form a triangle? Can you tell me?
Yeah.
Try to see if you could do that. Try to take three lines of the exact same size and form a triangle out of it.
No, you can't.
Basically,
wait.
Be a one of each square without one side.
Yeah, you can't. If they're all the same size, you can't form a triangle.
Wait,
so,
wouldn't that be
the same numbers?
In a right triangle? In a right triangle, I think the only thing that would satisfy that, actually, if I'm thinking about it here, the only thing that could possibly satisfy that is if we had, no, that wouldn't work. I'm trying to think if there's any scenario where that would work. Two squared. I mean, technically speaking, right, you could do something like this, 2 squared plus 2 squared, right? That's going to give me, you'd have to try to find the number that would be on the other side. 3 and 3 makes 9 and 16. I don't know. You'd have to go and find one. I've never seen it where they're the exact same, but possibly they could be, right? Because technically speaking, we could do this and this, right? So if this is 3 and this is 3, technically speaking, that would be 9 plus 9. So this would have to be, whatever this number is, somebody tell me, what's the square root of 18? It would be a weird number, but I mean, is it technically possible? Yes, but you see this
4.2.
So it would be technically, here's what we'd be doing. 9 plus 9 is equal to the square root of 18. Is it possible in theory? I guess so. Will you see it at this grade level? No, that's something you'll probably talk about more in geometry. Okay. Anyway. So here, we're solving this. 8 squared plus 15 squared, that's going to give me, no, hold on. Yep. 64 plus 225 is equal to 289. We add these together, I get 289 equals 289. Is that a true statement?
Of course.
Yes.
Yes. It's a true statement that says, it's really small. True statement that says these are, in fact, a right triangle. I'll write it bigger. It's true, which means it's a right triangle, okay? So we take the three values. We're trying to see if we can get a right triangle out of them. How might you see this? How might you apply it? You might be given a series of 6 numbers like this, and you might be asked to pick 3 values that would form a right triangle. The way to solve this problem is to take each of these numbers and square them, right? Because if you're using the Pythagorean theorem, don't you have to square all these numbers? And then what you do is you take 2 of the smaller numbers and see if you can get them to add up to equal one of the bigger numbers. So if I square 9, 8, 11, 12, 10, and 15, I get 81, 64, 121, 144, 100, 225. So looking at these 6 numbers, are there any 2 of the smaller numbers that if you add them together would equal one of the bigger ones?
Let's
see. If we take 64 and 81, that equals 145, which is not one of these numbers. So that's false. There's no right triangle possibility here. If we take 81 and 121, that gives me 202. That is false, no right triangle there. But what if we added 81 and 144? What do we get?
225.
So 81 and 144 equals 225. That's a right triangle. So the 3 measures that would work, 9, 12, and 15. Those would form a right triangle. You square them, and you identify which 2 smaller values will equal a larger value. This question here, just with different numbers, you might want to put a star next to it. You know where you'll see it again. Okay, so the last thing we have to do here. So far, everything we talked about has been two-dimensional. When we talk about three-dimensional, specifically the length of diagonal objects in the real world, such as if I wanted to know what's the largest flagpole I could fit in a box, that's a diagonal problem. When presented with a diagonal, which is a hypotenuse in the third dimension, there's a long, hard way to do this, where you have to use the Pythagorean theorem 2 times and try to find all these different measures. And then there's an easy way to do it. Let me show you the hard way would be to do this. Watch, but don't write, just pay attention. Here's the hard way. You're trying to find the length of A. So to do that, you'd have to realize that this is 6, this is 3, find the length of this hypotenuse. Once you know this, then you know that this is 4, and you can find the length of that hypotenuse. So you're doing 2 problems. However, I don't need to do this. When you're presented with a 3D object like this, and you're being asked to find the diagonal, here's how easy it gets. you have three measures here, right? 4, 3, and 6. It's called square, add, root, in that order. You take the values, 4, 3, and 6, you square them all. 4, 3, and 6, you square them. 4 squared is 16, 3 squared is 9, 6 squared is 36. You're with me so far? Now you guys can start writing. Once you do that, you add them together. And that's gonna give you 61. So remember the process. Square, add, root. We take the three values. Remember, this is only for three-dimensional objects. We're looking for the length of a diagonal. If it's two-dimensional, like a right triangle, then we just use the old Pythagorean theorem. Here, three-dimensional object, diagonals, we take the three values, 4, 3, and 6, we square them all, and we add them together. That's gonna give me 61. So I've done two things. I've squared them, I add them, what's the last word?
Root.
Root. I take the square root of 61, that's gonna give me 7.810 ... The reason for the three dots is because what type of number is this? It's an irrational number. It is a non-perfect
square.
Good job. So not only in this lesson are you proving, that's it. If you had done it this way, this is 3 and this is 6 and found this, and then gone and found this, you would have gotten the exact same answer. I prefer this way because it saves you a lot of time.
Yeah, work smarter now.
You all know how to use the Pythagorean theorem. For this, a little shortcut, copyrighted by me. All right. So, we take them, we square them, we add them, we take the root. As easy as this is, people do make mistakes on it because they start creating equations out of it. You don't need to. If you're dealing with a diagonal, look at the problem. Is this a 3D object? Yes. Diagonal, red flag, square, add, root. That's all it is. That's all it is. It is known as square, add, root. Very simple. Let's try another one here. Let's see if you guys understand what we're doing. So a box is used for shipping volleyball set. It measures 10 by 20 by 40. What is the longest length of a support pole that will fit into the box? Notice we're trying to find the length of the diagonal. Support pole. So we have three values, right? 10, 20, and 40. And we go through the process. We take all three values, and what do we do with them? We square them. It goes in that order. Square. You square the values. 10 squared, 20 squared, 40 squared. Once you square them all, you're going to add. Square, add, root. 100 plus 400 plus 1600. How'd you get 100? 10 squared is 100. 20 squared, 400. 40 squared, 1600. Square them, you add them, you get 2100. Yes, Dante.
So what if we added it first and then squared our
answer?
Don't
do
that.
Nope. Okay. It's got to go in this order. Square, add, root. You do any one of those steps wrong, as simple as they are, it's wrong. Okay? It's square them first, then you add them, then you're going to take the root here of what number? 2,100. You take the root of the number, and you get 45.825... Why? What type of number is this? It's an irrational number because this is a non-perfect square. We use the three dots to show you that it is irrational. It goes on forever and ever without terminating or
repeating.
So, questions on this? Questions. Keep in mind this is known as square and root. If you can remember those three things, whenever you see any one of these problems, super easy. These are the problems most people get wrong in the FSA because they don't know the short form. Only seen here on Math Matters Everywhere YouTube channel, brought to you in part by the Marshmallow.
Don't forget to like the videos, leave a comment, share it with your friends, and of course, subscribe.